And salutations. Welcome to the Willis Avenue virtual worship experience. We are so delighted that you're joining us today. I would like to take a moment just to recognize if you are a first-time guest, if you're a regular viewer, or if you're one of our family, we miss you tremendously. Whatever category you fall in, I invite you to participate in the comments section. We want to hear from you. This is 2021. It is a brand new year, contrary to how it might feel. It is a brand new year. And I want you to know that 2020 was exhausting. 2020 was heartbreaking. It was challenging. And we're in a new year. And so I invite you this year to partner with the church and to come behind the theme of the church. The theme of the church this year is shift. Sometimes in life, you have got to shift. Shift your focus, shift your mindset, shift your perspective. Sometimes you have got to switch gears. And so this year, I invite you to shift with us as we become the church beyond walls and we navigate this season that God has in store for us. Well, now is your time to be a digital evangelist, a digital disciple. Share this link, tell somebody, hit that like button, share and subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you can be informed on our latest videos. Well, without further ado, let's hop in today's worship.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid out, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid out, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
It's now time for prayer, and the Lord has invited us to come boldly to the throne of grace, where we can find mercy and grace to help in time of need. If you have a prayer request, please send it to the email address that's below, and we'll certainly put it before God in prayer. So let us bow our heads for prayer at this time. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, how excellent is your name in all the earth, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. Your name is worthy to be praised. Angels bow before you, and heaven and earth adore you. What a mighty God we serve. Lord, you are the Alpha, you are the Omega, you are the beginning, and you are the end. And nothing in our hands we bring, and we come to you, Lord, recognize that you are a God that is able to do abundantly above all that we ask or think. But Lord, we have sinned and come short of your glory. But you have said in your word, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, Lord. So cleanse us, Lord, create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. We come to you recognizing that you are an all-knowing God. You are an all-powerful God. You are a God that is in control. We recognize, Lord, what does that mean in this world today? There are a lot of chaos. There are a lot of fighting. There's a lot of problems, Lord. People's hearts are failing them for fear. But you promise that you'll never leave us or you'll never forsake us. So, Lord, give us trust in your word at this time. Help us to recognize, Lord, that if we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, that all other things shall be added unto us. Help us, Lord, to be anxious for nothing, not the political problems in this world, not the economic problems that we are faced with. Help us to be anxious for nothing, but in everything, help us through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving to make our requests known to you. Because you're a God that loves us with everlasting love. You care about us. You wish that none of us would perish, but all of us should come to repentance. So Lord, we ask you at this time to give us victory over sin. Give us, Lord, victory over the things in this life that easily beset us. Lord, we have a lot of problems that we are faced with. We are faced with a lot of challenges. A lot of challenges that are carried over from 2020. We have the COVID-19 virus that is still plaguing many. Many deaths have come about because of it. Many have been sick. So at this time, Lord, I know that you are the great physician. So touch those that are in the nursing homes. Touch those that are struggling in the hospitals. To provide a sense of hope and a comfort to those families who are giving up because their loved one is sick. Lord, we know that you're a God that can do anything but fail. Lord, assure us that despite what is happening in this world, you have everything under control. So help us, Lord, to turn our hearts to you, especially at this time. We pray for our church in a special way, and we pray that many will recognize that this is the time to give their hearts over to you, because the answer is not in political leadership. The answer is not in money or anything else, but Jesus, you are the answer for the world today. So help us to turn our lives and turn our lives over to you. Lord, we pray for the speaker at this time, and we ask you, Lord, to touch him or her with your mighty hand. Put a live coal on his or her lips, such that the word that they speak would be words of comfort, words that bring hope, words that will cause us to turn our hearts to you. Because one day, all this COVID virus is going to be over. One day, all this discrimination and systemic racism is going to be over. One day, all this deaths is going to be over. The pain and the suffering is over. Because the time is coming when you should come in the clouds of glory, when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Oh, we pray and we look forward to that day. But until then, Lord, help us to make our calling and election sure. Help us to be faithful to you, that we can go home to live with you through ceaseless ages of eternity. This is my prayer in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
This is the time where we worship God through giving. God has been faithful. God has been kind. God has been a present help. We believe that you should return from what you earn. That's tithing. You should return from what you earn. And as a tithing church, we invite you to partner with us to complete God's work for what God has provided you to bless somebody else. You have been faithful, and I thank you for it. I thank you for your generosity. I thank you for your gifts throughout this pandemic, and I encourage you to continue so that the work of God can go forward. There are several ways to give. You can give through Cash App. You can give through Zelle. You can give through AdventistGiving.org. You can give through our church website. You can mail in your gifts. But however you give not grudgingly nor out of necessity, but God loves somebody who can have a party over giving. I want to pray for you right now, that God will continue to bless you even as you exercise faith in this difficult time and exercise faith through your gifts. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your people right now. I pray you give them faith. I pray that you give them favor. I pray that you'd open every closed door. I pray that nothing will stand in their way, but as they exercise faith in you, that you will continue to be faithful to them. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen. Oh man, thank God for his goodness, grace, and mercy. And thank you for partnering with us. God bless.
I shall not fear the arrow by day, nor shall I fear the I'm not so
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on and magnify the Lord with me. Come on, let's exalt his name together. Come on, won't you praise the name of the Lord at all times and his praise continually be in your mouth. Come on and bless the Lord. I pray, hallelujah, that you are uplifted in that song. I pray that it inspired you on today. Hallelujah. We thank God for this opportunity to come together in this fashion so that we can exalt God's name. Today, I'm preaching to you from the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 21. I invite you to go there with me, Matthew chapter 21, beginning at verse 18. We're going to hop into the word, but before we go there, let us pause and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your goodness, grace, and your mercy. We ask you to hide me behind the empty cross so that you are the center of all attraction. May this word inspire, may it encourage, may it convict. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Matthew chapter 21, beginning at verse 18, and I'll be preaching today, reading from the Message translation of the Bible of the original text. And it says, early the next morning, Jesus was returning to the city. He was hungry. Seeing a lone fig tree along the road, he approached it, anticipating a breakfast of figs. When he got to the tree, there was nothing but fig leaves. He said, "No more figs from this tree ever." The fig tree withered on the spot, a dry stick. The disciples saw it happen, and they rubbed their eyes, saying, "Did we really see this? A leafy tree one minute, a dry stick the next." I want to preach today, lifting up that question. Did we really see this? Did we really see this? Sometimes looking in the mirror is very hard to do. Sometimes it's difficult to accept what's in front of you. Sometimes you can look at clarity, accuracy, and certainty and live in denial rather than accepting the truth. This is the sense and the sentiment of the late James Baldwin, that well-known and renowned Black author, thinker, writer, in his mentality in the 1960s. He said that for so long he had tried to save white America. He tried to explain away white America. He even tried to rescue white America. But Baldwin says he had simply had blinders on, and that denying what was really in front of him. But the day those blinders fell off was the day Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. Baldwin says King was an intellectual innocent. King was a prophetic preacher. King was a proponent of peaceful resistance. King was a good man, but he was assassinated in cold blood in this country. He says it was this, that it was then that this denial that he had and the delusion that he admittedly was under fell away, that white America didn't need a rescuing. It needed judgment to find the need to begin again. And for some of us, January 6th was a difficult look in the mirror. moment where we ask the question, what did we just see? Some of us may have sat in shock, maybe some of us in amazement, but all of us in disbelief that a mob of Trump supporters were led to the U.S. Capitol at the direction of the commander in chief, the president, to protest election results. A protest that turned into a riot. Yes, we've seen protests before, but this was so different. We've seen riots before, but this was so different. This was like a coup, an insurrection. This was anarchy. This was homegrown terrorism. They busted through windows. They stormed into the building. They made it into Senate chambers. They stole furniture. They defaced property. If this wasn't evidence before, if there wasn't evidence before, this ought to serve as evidence now that these people can't be rescued, but they need to be judged. Yeah, we don't have to wonder if Black Lives Matter did this, what would happen. We don't have to wonder if their skin complexion was different. We don't have to wonder because when Black Lives Matter came to that very same location and held a peaceful demonstration, they couldn't get on the Capitol steps. There were so many police that were surrounding them that what Baldwin saw, what America saw, that all makes us consider the common question, did we really see this? It's interesting as we dive into the text that the disciples of Jesus had a moment like that too. But what's bizarre is that Jesus is the reason that they raised the question, did we really see this? The writer of the text is clear that Jesus enters Jerusalem amid the praise of the masses that are gathered for Passover. In the morning, he rises early, traveling from the nearby town of Bethany. And when he spots a tree on the road, Jesus inspects the tree looking for figs, but finding fruit, and curses the tree. And the disciples have to be perplexed. The disciples have got to be confused by Jesus. They've got to be confused because Jesus cursed, but God is supposed to be blessing, not cursing. Yes, many of us have got to feel the same way. I thought only God blesses. Yeah, we are taught that God does the blessing, that God blesses families, that God blesses finances, that God blesses marriages, that God blesses neighborhoods, that God blesses everything. But the last thing that we were ever taught was that God curses, because the last thing that we know that God does is curse, because God blesses. Oh, but what the disciples failed to realize is that the state of the union was so certifiably bad that it made Jesus curse the fig tree. Yeah, meaning that the state of affairs of the nation was so bad that the tree was just a reminder of the stagnant state. In other words, the thing surrounding this setting, this symptom, was a greater symbol. God, I wish I could peel back the layers on what was going on in the state of Jerusalem at the time where Jesus utters these curses. Can I help you to see what is going on? That Jerusalem was a place where church leaders were literally in bed with political leaders. Jerusalem was a place with a megalomaniacal leader. Jerusalem was a place where they had a leader who presided over the death of babies, over the increase of poverty, and over the increase of aggression. One writer said, you don't even need the New Testament. Josephus says Pontius Pilate offended everybody. He offended the religious and the non-religious. He offended the poor. He offended the rich. He offended everybody that understands Jerusalem was a place where mob violence was minimized as freedom of speech. Jerusalem was a place that you could put an innocent man named Jesus on death row and give a presidential pardon to a guilty man named Barabbas. Jerusalem was a place that was full of contradictions, a place that was full of vices, a place that was filled with it. I'm just talking about Jerusalem today, and Jerusalem made him want to curse. The disciples didn't pick up on this truth because, like many others in their day, they were not kingdom minded. Can I take a slow walk down here? See, they were religious minded, but not kingdom minded. They were nation minded, but not kingdom minded. They were denomination minded, but not kingdom minded. They were politically minded, but not kingdom minded. They were America minded, but not kingdom minded. And I wonder while I'm on this road, if I've stepped on some toes, because some of us are relationship minded, but not kingdom minded. Some of us are nation minded, but not kingdom minded. Some of us are politically minded, but not kingdom minded, not denomination minded, but not kingdom minded. And all of those things come under the curse of Jesus. Watch this, watch this, watch this. How dare or how could Jesus curse the fig tree? I just want to go quickly through here because I want to tell somebody something today that it may not be or appear as an act of grace and a move of mercy, but Jesus curses it in order for it to begin again. Everything isn't about what God blessed. Sometimes it's about what God cursed. You see, because in an effort to keep us safe, God often has to debase some things. God often has to move some things. God often has got to curse some things. Now, I wish I had a witness through here to testify that there were some things in my life that God had to curse, or I never would have seen the wisdom and leaving or the folly in staying. There were some things that God had to curse, or I would have never seen the liberty of change or the bondage of complacency. There were some things in my life that God had to curse, or I would never have seen how something so small could be so big, or something so complicated could be so simple. That some of us need to see this so that we could see it's not bay, it's busted. It's not God, it's ghastly. It's not right, it's wrong. It's not edifying, it's deleterious to our health. We have got to understand that sometimes God is not simply in the business of blessing, but sometimes, contrary to what we learn in Sabbath school or Sunday schools, contrary to what we've heard on the pulpit in the pew, that sometimes God is not only in the blessing business, but God is also in the business of cursing. Come on now, God is sovereign. In other words, God can do what God can do. God can curse what God will. And I want you to understand today that God is willing to damage the thing that's damaging us so that he can secure our salvation. Yes, God is willing to damage to make sure that our salvation isn't damaged. Imagine what God is willing to curse in our lives in order for God to bless us. I'm so glad to know that God is cursing it, but he's keeping me. Yeah, this is not an emotional reaction. This is not an ego reaction. This is not an illogical reaction. It's an expression of the control of God. Yes, yes. God, I got to preach this thing. Through this curse, we see God's mission of mercy, because we see that God doesn't look at things the same way that we look at things. If we pay attention to what Jesus sees, we understand what Jesus values. Yes, and this text teaches us a couple of things that I want to bring before you today. It teaches us lesson number one, that God's mission is to meet our needs. God's mission is to meet our needs. Verse 18 says, seeing a lone fig tree along the side of the road, he approached it, anticipating a breakfast of figs. The fact that Jesus is hungry is that he knew what it's like to hunger. Jesus is hungry, but what the fig tree offers is no food at all. Yes, Jesus is looking to be satisfied. Jesus is looking for his needs to be met. Jesus is in touch with our feelings, of our the feelings of our infirmities. Jesus is touched with our grief. How many of you know that you can get it from God all of the day and any time of the day, that his mercies are new each and every day? He's looking at a tree and he's looking for sustenance. He's looking for something to meet his needs, but finding that the tree cannot meet his needs because the tree has no food to sustain on its branches. And I simply want to let somebody know that what that simply means is that while the tree doesn't have the resources, God can meet each and every one of your needs. And so when systems fail us, when people fail us, when institutions fail us, the good news here is that God has the sufficiency to meet each and every one of our needs. No matter what time of day or night, we can turn to God, and God is a need meter. God is a mind regulator. God is a burden bearer. God can meet each and every one of our needs. Yes, yes. When Jesus wakes up, he wakes up anticipating that the tree will meet the need, but the tree doesn't meet the need. And that simply points out the fact that no matter where we're going, no matter what we're facing, whenever we get into a situation where we need we have a need that needs to be met, there's a place that we can go and there's a person that we can see. Yes, God is on a mission to meet needs, but not only that, number two, not only is God on a mission that's going to meet needs. Number two, watch this. God's purpose is for us to produce. Yes, God wants to work on you, but not only that, God wants to work in you. Can I show you in the text? Verse 19 says, when he got to the tree, there was nothing but fig leaves. When he got to the tree, there was nothing but fig leaves. Yes, when Jesus noticed the tree, he saw that there were leaves. But on closer inspection, he realized that there was no fruit to go along with the leaves. What happened essentially is that the tree looked good on the outside, but it was producing no fruit on the inside. Can I make it plain that some of us look good on paper, but we're not really producing anything? The fig tree doesn't have fruit in it. It just has leaves. It looks good on the outside, but under close inspection, it's lacking. It's making movement, but it's not going anywhere. It's saying something, but it isn't doing anything. Most of what we ask for God is cosmetic. If there's nothing wrong with the cosmetic, we don't see for God, we don't see the need for God to do something. The problem is that often we are trying to measure the blessings of God based on leaves and not on the fruit. Let me say that one more time. The problem is that oftentimes we are trying to measure the blessings of God based on the leaves and not on the fruit. But you can't do that. You see, worship is less to do with an act of what we do when we're inside a building for 2 hours or virtually for an hour, and has much more to do with the lifestyle that we live. Worship has to do with what we prioritize. Worship has to do with not the cosmetic, but the core. Yes, are you uncomfortable if the cosmetics are good, but the core is empty? You see, because what the text is trying to tell us is that there are plenty of people that look good on the outside. They look good. They smell good. You think that they are doing good, but they are actually producing nothing. And the problem that so many of us have is that we measure ourselves against leaves, but we're not measuring ourselves against fruit. Do you understand that you can have a six-figure salary and still just have leaves and no fruit? You can be in a relationship or in a marriage with no fruit. You could have success and have no fruit. You could have a booming ministry and have no fruit. There are some of us that look at the leaves of the logos that people wear, or the car that people drive, or the school that people went through. But I wish I had folk that understand that it's not about the cosmetic, it's about the core. It's not about what you have on the outside, it's about what's going on the inside. And I'm so grateful that God looks deeper than the eyes can see, because God's purpose is to produce in us. You see, because God doesn't just want to work on you, God wants to work in you. Oh God, oh God, oh God, there are those who are walking this road of life, and they're walking, but they have no fruit in them. And God is saying, I don't want you to live unproductively, but I want you to produce something. I want your efforts to produce something. I want your prayers to produce something. I want your agonizing to produce something. And I wonder if I have somebody on the other end of the live stream that is willing to say in 2021, I want to produce. I want to leave this year more productive than I've ever had another year in my life. I want it to be productive in the way that I live my life. I want to produce. Yes, 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 yes. God is uncomfortable with unproductivity. God wants us to produce. God wants us to produce, number two. But number three, this text teaches us something else. And finally, the text teaches, watch this, that God's declaration is God's preparation. Oh God, I wish you'd get that with me. God's declaration is God's preparation. The text says that when he got to the tree, there was nothing but fig leaves. And he said, no more figs for this tree ever. Then he cursed the tree. And the word says that the tree withered on the spot and became a dry stick. What that simply tells us today is that what he declared is what God prepares. You see, when he cursed the tree, what God was simply doing was God was making room for something else that would be productive to grow in its place. I wish you received that. That Jesus is opening the possibilities for others to grow where this plant was stagnant. Now, I don't know who you are, but there's somebody that had the same opportunities as you, that say had the same education as you, that had the same family as you, but they have used every opportunity and squandered it, not being productive. But God says today that I'm going to clear the way so that you can produce where they were once planted. Yes, 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 yes. Yeah, yeah, there's no fruit without God. Yeah, you can do all of these things and nothing can come of it because you need God. Yeah, the way that the fig tree was cursed, I believe, was because God simply pulled back his blessings to show that you can't bear any fruit if I withdraw myself. If I withdraw myself, you'll bear nothing. You'll bear no fruit if I withdraw myself. If I withdraw myself, you'll bear nothing as a people if I withdraw myself. You'll bear nothing, no fruit in academics if I withdraw myself. You'll bear no fruit in marriage if I withdraw myself. You'll bear no fruit in finances if I withdraw myself. But I'm grateful today for the reason that we are still standing, still breathing, still striving, and still doing well. It's because God has been merciful not to withdraw his presence. It was, ha, hallelujah, watch this, the tree was living. Imagine that, breathing, moving, and going through photosynthesis. It was still getting watered. It was still getting sunshine. It's not like God allowed it to die. It was living, but it was not fruitful. And the worst thing is for you, is not for you to die. It's for you to be living, but not bearing fruit. Still living, but not fruitful. That is the ultimate curse. To be living and breathing and moving and not going through the everyday motions of life and then not to be fruitful. Yes, some of us think that fruitfulness is the emblem on the car you drive. That fruitfulness is the logo on the clothes you wear. But being fruitful is having the blessings of God in your life. Being fruitful is that no matter where you go, no matter where your feet trample, no matter if you've got sickness, no matter if you have issues, no matter if your relationship is torn, that you've still got the blessing of God on your life. I wish I had somebody that understands that. If God withdrew his presence from this life, if God withdrew his presence, I don't know what I would do. If God withdrew his spirit, I don't know where I would go. But I'm so grateful today that I've got a God that is with me through thick and thin, a God who's with me in good times and bad times, a God who is faithful, who is kind, who is true, who is merciful, a God who is there, who has prepared the place and prepared the season and prepared the time. I wish I had a worshiper that could magnify God, because God, hallelujah, will make room for you. God will make room, hallelujah, in places, hallelujah, for you. Yes, he will. As we see God clearing the clutter and making room, God destructs to construct. God removes to restore. God makes preparation to declaration. That the fact that I'm alive here today helps me to realize why Matthew included this episode in this gospel. Yes, he included it to show that there are still possibilities, even at times where we think that all hope is lost, that I thank God today because there's a possibility here to shift things in the right direction. Now, I wonder if I had someone here who would be willing to shift their focus. I wonder if I had someone here that would be bold enough to declare it's not over. I wonder if there was somebody who's bold enough to declare that God is not through with me yet. Did I see what I think I just saw? Yes. You saw God giving confirmation to the fact that it's not what God takes, but it's what God gives. You just saw confirmation to the fact that it's your season to live again. It's your season to grow again. It's your season to believe again. It's your season to try again. It's your season to fail again. It's your season to try again. It's your season to believe again, to go again, to seek again, to pray again. It's your season to fast again. It's your season to carry on the mantle again. It's your season to be missional again. It's the season, hallelujah, to take advantage of every blessing that God has in store for you today. Yes, yes, that's my prayer for you, and that is my plea, that you will accept that when God closes one thing, when God terminates one thing, is to shift our gaze somewhere else. So yes, yes, what you saw in the Capitol, that's foolishness. But what you're seeing in God is a moment, a prime moment of faith. And so, sir, ma'am, if that is you, you want to receive Jesus, I want to pray for you right now. If you want to shift in this movement of faith, I want to pray for you right now. Father in heaven, we pray for each and every person under the sound of my voice, that as they've heard this word, that they might grow closer to you and move closer in your direction. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. May God truly bless you today. Well, I pray that that message touched you. I pray that it blessed you, and I pray that it encouraged you. I pray that in this season of your life, that you understand it does not have to stop here, but that the journey to Jesus continues. If that is you, I invite you to reach out to us so that we can reach out to you and help you along the way in this journey to growing closer to God. Please hit that like button, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell. We want to spread this word as far as we possibly can and to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ. We will be back same time, same place, 11 a.m. on Saturday. And I pray that God gives you a wonderful week, and may God truly bless you today.